is one of the most important entry vectors for hackers. It's the heroes who are already thinking slow that you want to train. What are these trainings that lead to such a profound learning experience? The person will thank you for hacking them. Hi, this is Carsten from Hacking Matters, where each week we discuss best practices in cybersecurity. This week, we explore social engineering and how to protect from it. In fact, we'll do that this week and next week in two parts. This week, we dive into the human side, and next week, we dive into the technology side, both of which have to come together to become social engineering resilient. Social engineering is still one of the two most common entry vectors for hackers, the other one being technology vulnerabilities in your web apps and border equipment. In social engineering, hackers target both technology and human psychology. Today, we're exploring the human psychology side of things, and then next week, we're diving into the technology that makes a difference between being hacking resilient or being an easy mark. Social engineering is the art of tricking individuals into doing things that they wouldn't otherwise have done, and to help a hacker, for instance, to disclose a password, to log into some web application, to send files, to forward a text message with a secret code, any of those activities that you wouldn't usually do as part of your everyday activity, you can be tricked into it. Social engineering exploits the gullibility of individuals. It basically exploits our inherently trustworthy nature as humans, wanting to trust other humans, and thereby being tricked into doing something that's adversarial to our own company or to us as an individual. Companies have been trying to train away social engineering for a long time, and the fact that social engineering is still so prevalent tells you that these trainings are just not working. Let's explore a little bit why that is. And for that, we should remind ourselves in abstract terms how the human brain works, how, according to Daniel Kahneman, the inventor of behavioral economics, the brain has two different modes of operations. You might have heard people saying we only use 10% of our brain capacity. That's scientifically wrong, of course, but what is fair to say is that we spend 10% of our brain capacity on conscious things, while 90% of the brain activity works on unconscious things. Breathing, for instance, is one example of an activity we don't consciously think about most of the time, and it happens anyway. Kahneman distinguishes two modes of operations, a fast and a slow mode, which is actually the name of his famous book, Thinking Fast and Slow. And the fast activities are those 90% subconscious activities. The slow ones are the ones that we're actually aware of, where we do what humans would consider thinking. Social engineers try to trick you to stay in your fast thinking and go through the same motions you've done many times, type in a password, click on a link, open a document, without actually thinking about it. So if social engineers try to keep you in your brain function that you're not aware of, then of course security trainings have a hard time changing that, because the security training would only influence what you're doing in your aware part of the mind, in your slow thinking. So that's one of the big reasons why security trainings just don't work by and large in combating social engineering. Now that's not true in 100% of the cases. There are some people that already take security serious enough that they do make it a slow activity. They do think before clicking on a link or an attachment, before typing in their password. And so trainings can amplify those individuals that already make security a slow thinking activity rather than a subconscious activity. And we consider those the heroes. The heroes in security awareness are already not clicking on links though. So what more can you train them? You can train them to report suspicious activity. Now imagine a social engineering campaign to be unleashed against your company. To be successful, the criminal has to send dozens, if not hundreds, of emails. If that affects even just a small number of heroes, at least one of them will report the email, allowing you to respond to it, allowing you to investigate who all else got the message, perhaps delete them before they can even read them. But if they did read them, clicked on it, take evasive actions, changing their passwords, doing additional security monitoring. So it's the heroes who are already thinking slow that you want to train. Focus your trainings on the heroes rather than on everyone else who makes a lot of computer usage a subconscious activity of clicking, clicking, clicking without thinking much about it. I'll give you some data points from our experience of running phishing campaigns in large organizations, sometimes against thousands of individuals. These phishing campaigns are usually structured all the same way. You send a realistic looking phishing email to some people at your company, and if they fall for it, if they click on a link or open an attachment, you redirect them to a training where you basically say, you just fell for a phishing email. Here is what to consider next time. You know, look at the sender, double check these things. Just generally don't open attachments from unknown sources and whatnot. When running these campaigns, you do have a learning effect when measured a few weeks later. So when we ran a campaign 3 weeks later, 10 percentage points fewer people would click on the phishing email. Okay, that's great. However, 6 months later, that effect had diminished to about 2 percentage points. So people are pretty much back where they started in terms of clicking on emails because they hadn't received a reminder, and possibly the same company had trained them the other direction, onboarded them to all kinds of cloud tools that sent all kinds of emails all the time we have to click. So basically torn in both directions, and the learning effect diminishes. So consider an email campaign to be able to have a long-term improvement effect of 2 percentage points. Contrast that with training the heroes. Reporting an email that you find suspicious, where already you didn't click on it, but now go one more step, report it. And for instance, in the Microsoft cloud, this is a built-in feature. If you're on some other email provider, there's plugins for popular email platforms. So it really is a one additional click to report a phishing email. Not much work, but lots of intelligence for the security team knowing that there's a phishing campaign going on right now. Before asking people to report email, almost nobody does. It's just not an activity that you consider an option. Training those heroes who already don't click on phishing emails to go this one additional step increases in the long term the reporting rates by about 15 percentage points. So a more narrow training targeting fewer people has a much broader effect, because even just one person reporting an email campaign early on can of course disrupt the entire campaign. Train the heroes, don't try to make everyone change their subconscious behavior. That's near impossible. And yet, not all hope is lost. So if you do want to influence behavior of individuals, the best way that we have found is by individuals learning from others. So rather than learning through phishing campaign that they just clicked on or some online training, learning from their colleagues. Learning from colleagues can be possible in different ways. I'll just give you a couple of examples. One example is about the clean desk policy and specifically locking your computer when you're away. So what we do is we have little post-it notes that basically say, oh, I found your computer unlocked, I locked it for you, please pass on this message. And actually they come in stacks of 5. So you put those post-it notes onto somebody's computer, is it telling them, hey, I caught you doing something slightly out of policy, I helped you fix it, please help other people fix it as well. Now you have 5 of these notes that you can give to people, maybe in stacks of 2s or 3s. And so it multiplies. Learning from your peers in that way makes you a lot more considerate of your actions rather than learning from an anonymous computer training. Try this one out. It's easy, it can be fun, and it really is a team learning activity. Let me give you another example, this time around vishing. Stands for voice phishing, basically when you're trying to convince somebody to do an insecure action over the phone. Here you target a few individuals, perhaps each day, hoping that those individuals will have such a profound learning experience that they will tell their colleagues. We have statistically validated that people do spread the message, in that the closer you sit to somebody who was trained this way, the more learning you take away from it. What are these trainings that lead to such a profound learning experience? I'll give you one example. But let's say you call a colleague and you say, oh, I'm from IT, I wanted to remind you of the email backup system migration. We've been emailing you for a few weeks now. Just heads up, today's the last day for you to do migration. Tomorrow you'll lose access. And the person will say, I've never heard of the email migration. What do you want me to do? And you say, just okay, I'll send you the email one last time. I got to call a bunch of other people now. Good luck. That was the first call. You only need a second call to really drive a profound learning here. You call them again shortly before the end of the workday. And you say, I've noticed you have still not migrated your email. Is there anything I can help you with? And the person will say, I still haven't received any email. You say, oh gosh, you're the third person today. I don't know what's wrong in the system. Sorry, I don't think I can help you with this. And the person will start asking for help. Is there anything you can do? I don't want to lose access to my email. I need email. And you say, not supposed to, but okay, I can just do the migration for you. I have your username here. What's your password? Okay, the migration should be done now. So don't worry, everything will continue working as before. Thank you. The person will thank you for hacking them. And now you have the open mind. You have somebody who was just hacked and will listen to anything you want to teach them. And you say, I'm not actually from IT, I'm from the security team, and you just gave me a password. I could have been a hacker. I would now have access to your whole account. Let's walk through this. Let's talk about these steps. Let's talk about your password. That's not a good password. Let's talk about how to choose a good password. Yeah, that's a good password, but you just told me over the phone, so that's not a good password anymore either. Let's really think this through. How are you gonna choose your next password for this account? How do you make sure that there's different passwords for each different account that you're using? Have you used a password manager yet? A 5-minute conversation will drive more learning than any online training ever could. And we can measure statistically that this individual that we just trained through those two phone calls talks to their colleagues. So that whole team just got one vaccination shot. And if you do this every few months with one member of these teams, you do spread security awareness. So again, you're creating heroes rather than trying to prevent victims. Whilst our understanding of how to train individual grows using insights from psychology and actual hard evidence from running these campaigns in companies, because we are in an arms race with hackers. And if you reflect back on some hacking campaigns we know about from recent times, hackers have really gotten a lot more intense in their social engineering. At the large hacks in 2023, where the two big Las Vegas casino chains were targeted, we've seen very disturbing messages where people were social engineered, basically based on the pretense, I'm at your house, I'm with your family. If you ever want to see them alive again, you give me your password. Now, whilst all of this was made up, of course, you can understand how somebody feels under so much pressure in that moment that they will disclose their password, even if they're fully aware that this is impacting the security of their company. So social engineering is a problem. We can improve our resilience through psychology, but if hackers really go to the extreme events of blackmail and threatening violence, then all bets are off. And we have to assume that sometimes hackers do break in based on employee credentials. So next week, we'll look at some technology options of how to make that a lot more difficult. And as in our previous videos, we never aim for perfection. We aim for being better than average, for not being easy prey, for shrinking the likelihood that hackers target us through the hacking defense funnel, prevention, detection, and response. Hopefully this was helpful in thinking about social engineering, the human firewall side of social engineering. And next week, we come back to the technologies that can supplement and complement this strategy. If the thoughts on human psychology versus hackers helped you, please show it with a like and subscribe. Any questions, of course, let us know as well. Thank you for now and happy hacking.